I'm very pleased tonight to have the opportunity to introduce and present the recipient of the James Kirkpatrick Award. I want to thank the Johnson County Democrats for allowing me to do this. I also want to thank the Johnson County Democrats, I forgot to do this a minute ago, for their very early support of my campaign. It's good to have friends like the Johnson County Democrats, and I appreciate that very much. Tonight is a really very special night for a very special public servant, and it's a very well-deserved award. His service reflects the very spirit of James Kirkpatrick, putting the needs of Missourians first. You know, politics can be fairly complicated, but the politicians, the office holders, elected officials like James Kirkpatrick and Congressman Cleaver know how to simplify it for us. They know how to make it very clear to us who is watching out for us and watching out for Missourians. You know, at last year's event, he did such a fantastic job that we have talked about it for a year. And so we're very honored to get to hear him again. Please welcome Congressman Emanuel Cleaver.
I was telling somebody in the car on the way down here that James Kirkpatrick probably holds the record for being elected in this state, maybe in the nation. And it's a name that will not fade from our memory. And the great grandchildren and the great great grandchildren will hear people speak about their great-great grandpa and how well respected he was in this state. And anyone who ever gets anything to put on a shelf or in their home that has the name Kirkpatrick on it will be eternally grateful and thankful. And I am indeed that here tonight. We've got to elect Susan Monte to become the Lieutenant Governor. I'm not mad at the other people who are in the Democratic primary. I'm not mad at them. I don't even know who they are. So I couldn't be mad at them. But what I am is excited about her campaign and her candidacy and the chance that we have to win that office with her. And I think she is going to be a fabulous Lieutenant Governor. I think she already understands the office. She understands how to negotiate all of the difficulties that one would experience in Jefferson City. She's going to be great. And I look forward to getting on an airplane every Monday with my friend, Teresa Hensley, flying to Washington. That's going to be fun. You need to understand, when I get on the plane on Monday, it's five Republicans to one to me, and because the Republicans from Kansas they don't have airports there, so I'm not mad. They don't have airports, and so they fly out of Missouri, and so I have to fly on a plane with all of them, and it would be so joyful to have her on that plane. And they're nice. I mean, I don't have arguments on the plane, but we don't talk either. So if you don't talk, you don't argue. So I think she is going to be a great member of the House of Representatives, and I was afraid for maybe a couple of weeks that she was going to make a decision not to run, and I thought that if she had not run, I don't think there's anybody who would have had an opportunity to pick up this seat. And keep in mind that Columbia, Missouri is a Democratic town. And there's a college campus there. And where there is education, there are Democratic voters. support her. I'm going to send a letter to Johnson County Democratic Chair to invite all of you to my annual backyard barbecue. I think I can say this without fear of contradiction. It is maybe the only barbecue in the state that's larger than the American Royal. And some of you have been there every year, and you will bring in guests from Washington, from the House, maybe even the Senate, but we also eat not a gauge barbecue and have a good time as we prepare to win in November. It is not going to be easy. Let me just tell you that the nation is badly divided. The presidential election should not be close. It will be. Not because we don't have the best candidate, but because Congress has helped to polarize the nation. And so we are pathologically partisan and polarized as a nation. On November 5th, Barack Obama and Mitt Romney will wake up with 45% of the electorate. The election is about 10%. Those are the independents. And right now, I would think that they're leaning toward us because of the ridiculous conversations that our opponents are having about women and women's rights. So unless something dramatically changes, I think we are going to be in a fight all the way to the end. But I do think that we can win not only the presidential election, but I also think that we have some advantages in winning the House. Keep in mind, friends, we only need 25 seats in the House. The Republicans won 76 last time to kick us out of power. We just need 25. So we have a chance to do that. And that's one of the reasons I think Teresa Hensley has a very good chance to win. But the main reason is that she's the best one. I'm not mad at her. It's not personal. It's just a fact. And I am hopeful that we can get people like Teresa in the House because we've got to change the conversation that's taking place in Washington. Most of you, or maybe some of you or your neighbors, probably believe that beginning this Monday when we go into session and through next Thursday when we end for the week, that people will be sitting around working on the Herculean problems facing you and your neighbors and your family members. High gasoline prices. Jobs. What are we going to do about spending $2 billion a week in Afghanistan and Iraq? $2 billion, all of which is borrowed. 42 cents on every dollar is borrowed. And the war is dragging us down economically. And we will never recover completely till we stop the wars. We have 1,000 military bases. 1,000 military bases around the globe. We have military bases protecting Eastern Europe from the Soviet Union, which does not even exist. And so we need people to begin to change the dialogue. Some of you probably think people are meeting, trying to figure out a way to deal with the immigration problem. Ladies and gentlemen, there will be no meeting on immigration next week. There will be no meeting on oil. There will be no meeting on jobs. There will be no legislation coming to the floor. There will be no legislation being discussed in a committee. In the capital of the United States of America, the issue that you are concerned about will not be discussed by a single committee in Congress. And every American who understands what's going on in Washington ought to be just outraged. We're going to waste time next week naming post offices. I'm not mad at post offices. I used to have one down the street. We have decided that it is more important to scream at each other and end up getting a lot of TV time than it is to work on the problem that you're concerned about. Much of the problem, and I hope you will tell your friends as the campaigns roll on, much of the credit for the acrimony in Washington goes to the voters. Elections have consequences. Now, let me just tell you, I put somebody in an office who has no reservations about screaming out during the State of the Union speech. The only time in U.S. history as the President of the United States can interrupt in the State of the Union speech. Joe Wilson from South Carolina, Yale, July. So what happened to Joe Wilson? Well, in 10 days, he raised $2 million for his re-election campaign. $2 million. So when the American public starts talking about nothing is being done, hush. You're contributing to it when you send those kinds of people to Washington. He paid no price for embarrassing the House of Representatives. He paid no price for embarrassing the government of the United States of America. We have foreign dignitaries sitting in there. Even in some of the banana republics, they don't get interrupted. Because they get shot if they do, but the point is that is just an insult to who we are. Compromise now in Washington is viewed as capitulation. Now the problem is, if you believe that God sent you to Congress, then you know that everything you do is correct. That God baptizes every vote you make. And that's one of the problems we have. I'm an ordained United Methodist minister. I gotta have a master's. I've read all 66 books. But one of the problems we have now is many of the people who are elected are more religious than God. And so when they vote, God just voted. They don't understand that the voice they hear is not necessarily God's voice, but their own voice in disguise. And the more you have people who stand up and say, well, God put us here. Look, as I was on Meet the Press last Sunday morning, I said to in the conversation with some of the folk, including Billy Graham's daughter, who was sitting to my left, I said, look, I'm not voting for Mitt Romney. I won't vote for him. I'm not voting for him. But I could care less whether he worships a tree or a rock. I'm more concerned about the religion in Washington called Confucianism than I am about Mormonism. And what people forget is that the Sixth Amendment to the United States Constitution, Section 3, says there shall be no religious test. And we've got to stop this. So what we say, you have to go out and, on a campaign trail and talk about God. There's something called Phariseeism. And people forget this. I read this in a book the other day. It said, when you pray, do not pray on the street corners as do the Pharisees, who pray to receive the attention of men. When you pray, go to your closet and pray to your Father in heaven. Now some of the Christians have read that. They don't talk about that part. And so the American public is participating in the demise of its own republic. The issues are on our side. We have the issues on our side. How do I know that? The big five oil companies had a joint profit or combined profit in 2011 of $137 billion. I just said that's what they made. That's the profit. $137 billion. The Center for American Progress, their poll. And 59% of the American public believes that they should not get that $4 billion annual tax cut. Think about this, $137 billion in profits, and then they take another $4 billion of your tax money? We had a vote on it 4 weeks ago. The Republicans voted to continue to give people the money. $4 billion. Now, why? Well, if you just look back, you will find that the Republican Party receives a lot of gasoline money to run their campaigns. Big Oil has already contributed, as of this week, $20 million to Republican candidates for this election cycle. $20 million so far. But if you do the polling, and you understand where the public is, you can talk about it. The public is with us. They don't agree with what's going on. When you tell them that that these companies raised $137 billion, and that's up 75% from 2010, we are in a recession. A 75% increase in profits. And we're going to walk around feeling sorry for them. And then there are folks who want to say, well, President Obama is responsible for high gas prices. If that's the case, the tooth fairy is responsible for your tooth coming loose. Look, speculation is one of the problems. Wall Street speculation causes a great deal of the problems we have, and the oil prices have risen 16% since January 1st. 16%. Now, the oil companies will start getting their people to say, well, we got to drill, baby, drill, baby, drill, 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 baby, drill, drill, baby. The poll says that the majority of the American public won't buy that. Will not buy them because they realize that right now, and most people don't know this, domestic production of oil is up right now at an 8-year high. So long before Obama came to office, the production revved up, and now it's at an 8-year high. So when they said we need more production, we've gotten more production. It has never been this high in history. Well, they continue to say that. We win that argument. They lose. They lose. Even if they say God wanted higher gas prices, we win that argument. Now we have some people in this country who work against their own best interests, and they do it every day. They vote against themselves. I had a guy in Washington who told me that, he said, you know, I'm a wealthy man, I'm a Republican. And he said, how many of us do you see marching out there with the Tea Party? Zero. They don't have to march for them. The Tea Party marches for the others, and the Republican Congress votes for them. They want to give tax cuts. Do you know that if we stop the Bush tax cuts, we drop $50 billion in our deficit over a 10-year period? This country had a nervous breakdown for a while. We are the only nation on planet Earth in the history of this nation, this world, the whole world, to give two tax breaks as we are entering and after we enter a war. Nobody gives a tax cut in the middle of a war. But we did. And we made war impersonal. Because there's no draft, nobody has to think about those soldiers coming home. And when Congresswoman Hensley joins me in Washington and we go visit the troops up at Walter Reed, you see, as I've seen a young man with both arms and both legs blown off, laying in a hospital bed, nobody can tell you why we're still there. We are shopping. They're over there fighting and coming home with mental problems that could have a negative impact on the rest of us. And what we need to do is understand that we do have a budget problem and a deficit problem and a debt problem. But friends, if you look at the budget that was just approved by the House, it is menacingly mean. Tell you what, we said, we are falling behind the Chinese in science and in math. They are already ahead of us in terms of environmental development. I mean, all of the wind turbines that you see in the United States now are purchased from China. So we said, we're falling behind in education. So some smart Republicans said, all right, we're going to get back at these Chinese. We're going to cut Head Start. And then, if that won't get them, we're going to cut Pell Grants. If that won't get them, we're going to cut GI benefits. We'll trick those Chinese. The budget of the United States is a reflection of the somebody-ness of this nation. It is a statement about who we are. It says what we believe. You show me your checkbook, and I can tell you what you believe in, but you'll spend the money on what you believe in. And this nation took 62% of the cuts in the budget that just passed the House out of programs for people, for human beings, for children, for the poor, for the aged. That budget says are a nation that is mean. That's not who we are as a nation. We're better than that. We are much better than that. And if those cuts end up being approved in the Senate, which they won't, but just think about what would happen. Just think about what would happen. And the majority of the public is with us on the budget. I tell people about Henry Block calling me on the phone and watching, screaming at me. And Henry saying, what's wrong with these people? He said, I've been a Republican all of my life. I just gave $30 million to UMKC, and these people up here telling me that I don't need to pay more taxes? He said, I'm a rich man. We had a long conversation. Henry wrote an op-ed as a result of our conversation. It ended up in the Kansas City Star. Go home and pull it up. Read it. It's from a multimillionaire who knows a little bit about taxes. Who says, why are you trying to give me a tax cut? People understand right and wrong. People know what's not good and in the best interest of this nation. When you think about the fact that five of the top hedge fund managers, the individuals, earned $4 billion apiece last year. $4 billion with a B. And that's not the end of how they messed over you. Then they paid 15% for capital gains and dividends tax. You paid 27 to 31, maybe 32%. Are you telling me that's right? You tell me that's the American way? You tell me that the majority of Americans believe that? No, they don't. We have the issues. We are right. Now, if rich means that I ignore poor people, I don't want to be rich. If Republicanism means that I support the rich and push aside the wounded, and I'll never be a Republican. We have a challenge ahead of us like we've never had before. If we are not able to stop the movement of this country toward dismantling government, just think about this. People are saying, we need to eliminate government, too much government. And they're running for office to be a part of the government. Spending millions of dollars. What's going on now is an ideological battle over the role of government. And the Democrats believe that government steps in where nobody else can step in. That's what we believe. We believe in adequate help for the needy. We believe that everybody in this country is important, that nobody gets the preference over anybody. That's what we believe. And people will connect with us. There's a little girl playing around in the house, so she runs into the room where her dad is working. He has his office in the home, so he's in there working. So she comes in and she accidentally closes the door on her fingers and she starts crying. And so the father says, oh, sweetheart, you'll feel better in a minute. And he continued to work on his computer. And the little girls cry and cry. And then she started crying louder and louder. And he said, you'll be okay, you'll be okay. And then he went back to work. And she got so loud that she aroused the attention of the mother, who then came in and said, honey, what's wrong? And she said, I slammed my door, my finger in the door. And she said, is it hurting that bad? And she said, yes, yes. And she said, well, why is it hurting so bad? The little girl said, because daddy didn't say ouch like he usually does. There are a lot of people who are hurting. Democrats have historically said ouch. Somebody else hurts, we say ouch. Somebody hurt, we hurt. We are the party of the people. That's why we are union folk. That's why we support unions. The only thing separating us from 7 days a week on a job and 14-year-olds working, labor unions. And now there is this attack on labor unions. Let us never stop supporting labor unions. That is what we need for the people of this country to make progress. We are labor union people. We stand up for the workers in this country. Our parents were workers. And as you are out campaigning and talking to people, just walk up and say, ouch. I don't know what your problem is, but ouch. I don't know what you need, but ouch. I'm a Democrat, that's what we do. We hurt for each other. That's what we've got to do. 2 years ago, we lost. And erroneously, before we started really checking, we started saying the Republicans had a wave and they turned out and they kicked us out of the leadership in the House and almost took control of the Senate. Wrong. We didn't vote. Republican turnout 2 years ago was big. And we walked around and sat at home. And this is what we get. This is what we get. And what we've got is not good for the nation and it's not good for the world. The only way this is going to turn around is us. The Republicans, as bad as they are not going to voluntarily leave. I know, I conducted a poll. Every Republican I know, I asked, will you voluntarily leave? And unless something has changed, the answer is no. And so if they won't leave, then there's only one way for this to end. And that's for us to end it for them. Let's take them out of their misery. Democrats don't wake up in the morning and check to see if their name is still in the Bloomberg Billionaire Index. We don't do that. We already know that we're not there. And we also know that unless we help, there's not going to be nobody around. I mean, these folks want to. You want to talk about an issue? Let your neighbors know that the budget that was just approved by the House, it indexes Medicare. It voucherizes Medicare. I mean, they want to damage one of the most successful programs we've ever had. They've always hated Social Security. Think of what would have happened when we successfully fought George Bush's Social Security plan out, where they wanted people to invest in Wall Street. Think about what would have happened if that had happened. We are the people who protect the people. All the people, including the people who don't vote. We had a Sunday school superintendent who I went around to just with him to try to see what was going on in summer school. That's one of the most important programs in the church. So we went around to the classes and and looked at the Sunday school teachers trying to get through to the kids. We went in one class, and I told the teacher, I said, I'd like to ask this, you know, your kids some questions. And she said, oh, sure. So I said, Billy, I want you to stand up and tell me, and the Sunday school superintendent, you guys have studied this. Who knocked down the wall of Jericho? And he said, Rev, I didn't do it. I came here, well, as soon as I got to church, I came straight in the building. He said, if you don't believe me, you can ask the teacher, she saw me coming in. And so I looked at the teacher, and she said, you tell you right, Rev. And she said, I'm a witness, I'm going to tell you, I saw him. He didn't do it. So I turned around and said, thank you, and I left. So we had an administrative board meeting, a combination of the Methodist Church Council and ministries. And so I just stood up, I said, look, this has gotten out of control. I said, we've got to completely retool our summer school program. This is sick. And I said, if the bishop came in here and started asking questions, and he'd get the answers like I got, I said, I'm going to be removed as a pastor. And I said, I went into Mrs. Nash's class, and I asked Billy, who knocked down the wall of Jericho, and he denied it. And I said, if it didn't get that much better, the Sunday school teacher who I thought we were training, she corroborated his statement. So the trustee chairman said, we don't care who knocked it down, Reverend. We're going to pay for it. And that's what Christians do. Friends, let me tell you. The wall that divides this nation on the basis of skin color, that wall must come down. The wall that separates women's wages from those of men, that wall must come down. The wall that separates by miles the distance between the have-nots and the have-mores, that wall must come down. The wall that separates people on the basis of Phariseeism, that I'm closer to God than you, that wall must come down. And the only candidates to bring that wall down are Democrats. We are